I don't know whether to call this a structure, a mechanism, or a material. Well, I suppose it's a material that has mechanisms embedded within it that result in it having an interesting structure. The designer calls it a bistable auxetic structure, so we'll go with that, but I don't think the name does it justice because it does so much more than being bistable and auxetic. This video is sponsored by KiwiCo. More about them at the end of the video. Let's pick that name apart though, bistable auxetic. You may have come across auxetic materials. Auxetic materials are materials that behave in a weird way when stretched or squished. Blue tack, for example, isn't auxetic. If you stretch blue tack in one direction, it gets thinner in the other direction. That's quite normal behavior. Auxetic materials do the opposite. When you stretch an auxetic material in one direction, it gets wider in the other direction as well. And in fact, there's a whole spectrum of possible behaviors when you squish and stretch a material. We assign a number to the behavior of a material called the Poisson number. Normal materials have a positive Poisson number, like blue tack. When it's stretched in one direction, it contracts in the other. An auxetic material has a negative Poisson number. When it's stretched in one direction, it expands in the other direction as well. But you also get materials with a zero Poisson number. Cork, for example, has a Poisson number of about zero. Meaning, if you squish it in one direction, actually nothing happens in the other direction. And that makes cork really useful for stopping up wine bottles. When you press down on the cork to get it inside the neck of the bottle, it doesn't expand sideways, which is good because if it did, you wouldn't be able to get it in the bottle. But how can a material have a negative Poisson number? Well, it's all to do with how smaller components of the material move around each other. See how these small triangles hinge around each other and how that forces there to be extra space between them. Here's another example. As I pull on this square, the smaller squares rotate around each other according to the pattern of hinges, causing the whole thing to expand in both directions. Side note, I actually made this contraption a while ago and I put whiteboard adhesive on all the squares. That's because I had this idea that I might be able to put an image on those squares that works in both orientations of the mechanism. I never managed it, but if you're inspired to have a play, I'd love to see what you come up with. The best place to share your creations is on the Science Fair Project channel on my Discord server. Link to the server invitation in the description. In my video about flexible polyhedra, Jessen's polyhedron is auxetic. Squishing it in one direction causes it to squish in the other direction. Actually, the other two directions. So this is auxetic material. But it's also bistable. You encounter bistable mechanisms all the time in your everyday life. For example, light switches. Look, this light switch is stable in the off position. If I push it a little, it returns to the off position when I stop pushing it. But if I push it hard enough, it will flip into a different stable state. So a light switch has two stable configurations, and I can move between them by overcoming some minimum force. This switch is constructed of several parts, all working together, but it's possible to construct a bistable mechanism from a single part, so long as the material is somewhat flexible. I printed this with a material called PETG, and look, it has two stable configurations. You could also call this a compliant mechanism. I'll leave a link to Derek's video about that over on Veritasium. But there's something even more interesting going on here. Not only is this material bistable, one of the stable configurations is curved into this interesting shape. It turns out it's possible to tune the material so that the deployed state is any shape you like, well, almost any shape. I spoke to Tian Chen, who co-authored a paper about it. He showed me the basic building blocks of the material, and it's really clever. See, when you pull on this thing in one direction, it expands in the other direction. So if we tessellated them together, we'd have an auxetic material. But watch that animation again, and this time I want you to focus on these cuts here, marked in red. Notice how the pieces move apart as the shape is stretched. But crucially, by the end, they have come back together. The same is true for these cuts. These parts are together at the beginning and at the end, but they're separate in between. So what would happen if we simply didn't make those cuts? Well, if the material was elastic, like rubber, those parts would stretch as you pull on the material, but crucially, they would be at a maximum stretch halfway through the sequence. Meaning, once you've passed the middle, those stretched bits of rubber will actually be pulling the material towards the final state. In other words, the material will be stable in both configurations. Just like the light switch, it will be bistable. How cool is that? Tian Chen and his colleagues didn't actually come up with that bit. That was the work of Ahmad Rafsanjani and Damiano Passini. They saw some interesting geometric tiling in Iran and wondered how a rubber sheet would behave if it was cut according to the tiling. And it turned out to be bistable and auxetic, though the material remains flat in both stable states. So how do you make it pop out into three dimensions? Well, what Tian Chen did was to look at one of the triangles that makes up the hexagonal lattice unit. And actually, there are a couple of parameters you can play with. You can vary the length of this line, let's call that length T. So there's a whole range of cuts to explore there. And then you've got this angle, let's call that theta. So you've got all these cuts to explore. You can vary T and theta independently, and you get different properties. For example, on the left, the length T is long and the angle theta is large, whereas on the right, T is short and theta is small. They're both bistable auxetic structures, but one expands more than the other. And so then you say, suppose I want this sheet to turn into a dome. Well, then you need the middle of the rubber sheet to expand more than the perimeter of the rubber sheet. So you start off with your pattern of triangles. It's the same across the whole rubber sheet. And then you tweak those two parameters, T and theta, until you get just the desired amount of expansion at every point on the sheet so that it becomes a dome. And that's what you have here. Isn't that amazing? By the way, you could also just make the triangles in the middle bigger to get more expansion there. That's demonstrated with this non-bistable material. See how it collapses when the deploying force is removed. But in general, the issue with just making the triangles bigger in the areas where you want more expansion is that, well, the computation becomes harder, but also you might end up with really big flat bits and really small complex bits. Here's a question though, how do you decide which parameter to change and by how much? Because you've got T and theta. You can vary either of them to get the amount of expansion that you want. So how do you choose? Well, this here is a heat map showing how much does the rubber sheet expand as you vary T, which is shown on the vertical axis, and theta on the horizontal axis. Lighter regions on the heat map show more expansion. So if you want a specific amount of expansion, say this much, well, actually, you've got a whole line here of possible pairings of T and theta to choose from that will give you that much expansion. So the way you pick is, well, basically, you do a load of modeling in a computer to show you how stable the structure will be for all these different values after it's deployed into the dome shape or whatever. See, in this simulation, as the sheet is being stretched, the graph shows how hard it is to stretch it. And actually, it's this graph that tells us that it's bistable. You've got these two energy minima. If you can put enough energy into the system to overcome this hump, then you'll land in this valley. So when we're thinking about what values of T and theta to choose, we're thinking about this graph. If we want this structure to be stable, which is to say, if we don't want it collapsing back to that flat state, then we want to maximize this distance. We need to make the valley as deep as possible to make it harder to get out of. And so you create another heat map, but this time showing how deep this energy well is for different values of T and theta. So going back to this heat map, you have the curve of possible T and theta values in yellow that gives you the amount of expansion you want. You overlay that yellow curve onto this heat map, and you pick the point along that curve that gives you the deepest valley. Interestingly, the structures aren't that easy to undeploy. You have to kind of massage the thing all over to get it flat again. So it might be that T and theta are too optimized. You might be asking what sort of applications there might be for a material like this. Well, one obvious one is medical stents. At the moment, stents deploy into straight tubes, but arteries aren't always straight. Wouldn't it be great if we could design a stent that grows to the exact right size and shape when it's deployed? Also noteworthy is the fact that a self-assembling auxetic protein lattice has been developed. It works in a very similar way to my linked squares, actually. How cool would it be to play with a material that's auxetic and bistable at the molecular level, a material that snaps between two sizes? Maybe one day. Guess what came today?
What?
KiwiCo! I've been getting KiwiCo for my kids for a long time now, and I've noticed something really interesting. So KiwiCo is this subscription service for STEM projects. Every month you get a crate in the post and it has everything you need for a really fun, hands-on STEM project. And the thing that I've noticed is this. There are 9 different lines for every possible age group. And typically I'll get a box that's above the age of my kids and I'll do the project with them. And one thing you discover as a parent is human beings have to learn absolutely everything. It's like Kids don't know how to use a spoon to eat cereal. They're not born with that skill. And you watch your kids at a very young age, like, failing at something really simple like that. And so with KiwiCo, I'm showing them, like, this is how you use a screwdriver. You know, this is how you join two things together in this particular way or whatever. Here's this lever mechanism. Now, it's been so long they've been doing KiwiCo, they're really proficient in all these things, like tool use, ideas about mechanics and engineering and electronics. They have a bit of an intuition for this stuff now. Like, they think like makers. KiwiCo isn't just a subscription service, by the way. You can also get one-off crates from KiwiCo store, which is perfect for the holiday season. The other thing that I really like about KiwiCo is the replay value. Like, my son has been playing with this crane for days now, to the point where it's annoying. Like, you know, it's time to tidy up the mess that they've made, and it takes him about an hour because he's tidying up using the crane. If you're interested in KiwiCo, then the promotion on this one is really good. If you go to kiwico.com/Steve Mould and use promo code Steve Mould at checkout, you'll get 50% off your first month. The link is also in the description, so check out KiwiCo today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe. And the algorithm thinks you'll enjoy this video next.